everyone, this is Ishtar with another episode of the Naked Shaman. It's good to be talking to you today. I want to talk to you about a sort of blinding flash of realization I had last night when I was chatting to someone. And it's a little bit about perspective, and it's a lot about how to save your life. So I want to go into a little bit about that today, and also I'll go on to some other things as well that you might find interesting. I'm very aware that I'm building up a little bit of a following now, and it's great, and it's lovely to feel part of a community of people that are interested in what I have to say, because most people in the world aren't. So I really appreciate all the listeners and all the people that click like on my posts, and a lot of them as well, I like their posts too. So it's great, there's this kind of interaction of people that are becoming more and more enlightened about what's going on in the world, on the world stage, what actually the human life is all about, and it's, you know, useful to all of us. But I also want to say that there's a huge difference between listening to what I have to say or reading what I have to say, and actually doing what I do, which is shamanism. And at the end of the day, that's going to mean the difference, because at the moment we're still tiptoeing up to some sort of end game cataclysm on the world stage. Well, nobody quite knows what is going to happen. But when push comes to shove, and push is going to come to shove, when the internet comes down, when you'll no longer be able to have access to teachings like mine, and maybe even my teachings will be outlawed, and maybe even I will be dead. That's the worst case scenario, but, you know, let's face it, it's happened so many times before that they always take out the enlightened information distributors because we're a problem to them. So when that happens, you will only be left with yourself and what you have yourself, not what you believe or not what you've heard someone say on an alternative radio station. That won't really serve you very well, because it's just a belief, it's just something you think is probably true because you quite like the person and they make sense to your worldview. And that's fine for now, but you're going to need, in fact already we do need, to come into a situation where we're totally, totally self-empowered in ourselves, in and of ourselves, if we're to be of any use to ourselves and our families and friends and anyone else. So I want to just say that when I talk about shamanism, it isn't because I want to talk about shamanism or because I'm on an ego trip or something and I want to maybe boast about something that I do. The reason I talk about it is because I want people to realize that they need to do it. And it isn't something that's kind of even extra that you have to take from the outside and put in your pocket. It is something that's already inside, but it does have to be taught, and it has to be activated by a shaman who's already activated. It's something that's all, you come with the software. Every human being comes with the software. This is not a nice to have extra add-on. It is already built into the human being. And the biggest wake up that we all need to face is that over the last at least 2,000 years, this has been gradually dumbed down and dumbed down in us to the point now where we, it's been so driven. It's the meaning of the word occult. It's been so hidden from us that most people don't even know that that is a part of who they are anymore. And the purpose of this has been very deliberate. I don't think you have to be a conspiracy theorist to see what's been going on, that we're being gradually turned into robots so that we're better prepared to be slaves to the 1% who've cooked up this whole scenario. And they don't want thinking slaves, and they don't want inspired slaves or empowered slaves. They just want drudges, really. worker bees. And so this is why it's just been gradually hidden, this knowledge about who we are. Now they have this knowledge and they use it against us. We need to have this knowledge so that we can protect ourselves from them and become empowered in who we are. That's the difference between us and them. By them, I think you know who I mean. They're the people that are treating the world stage like it's their own personal theatre, and staging wars and staging false flags. They are different to us. They've been brought up very, very different to us. They are the children of the children of the children, going back hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years of abuse. They are all products of abuse and torture and satanic rites. And so it's a bit of a waste of time to try and persuade them at this stage that they need to listen to us, because they're not going to. They're not in a fit state to. They are so abused, they cannot see. They don't see the world like we do. They see it from the point of view of survival of the fittest and who gets the richest. And that's all they can see. So for now, we will have to park that to the side and look at ourselves, because it's only in realizing who we are, becoming self-empowered in our own right, that then we will know what to do. It isn't that there's a one-size-fits-all solution, but there will be solutions, because the solution to any problem is found in the seed of the problem. It's found in the cause of the problem. And one of the things that this 1% do is try and distract us from the cause of the problem so that we can't find the solution to the problem. This is just one of the many, many benefits of starting to work shamanically, is that you do start to see things for how they are. It's like Neo, who took, I think it was the red pill, wasn't it, in the Matrix. This is like taking the red pill. Before Neo took the red pill, he saw the world in a certain way, and then he took the red pill and he saw the world completely differently. He saw actually what was going on. We all need to see what's going on in our own right and not be dependent on one or two people who we think may be able to see what's going on. We're used to behaving like this because we've been brought up to follow leaders, but it's really not very helpful to follow leaders, because it's very disempowering to give all your power to another person that you're following and believing in and trusting in. And also, they're human too, and they're going to make mistakes, and then your whole world's going to fall apart when they say something that turns out not to be right, but you know, they were doing their best, but it just wasn't, they're not perfect, you know. And they're, everyone's on their own path too, so it's not like anyone is absolutely there in full enlightenment and can guide the others. There is not one person on this planet like that. We're all in various stages of going forward, and some of us are a few steps ahead of the others, and that's all. But we're all capable of falling down a pothole. It's important to understand this. It's important to understand that this is inside of you. You can become this self-empowered so that you're making YouTube videos like this one, or you're writing blog articles, or you're painting in a certain way to express this energy, this beingness of truth. And I will say one thing about this time as well, because certainly where I live in Glastonbury, it's almost like a golden age of creativity here, and I think it is being forced by what's going on and by people waking up. But everybody is painting, writing, singing, dancing here. And it's just like an explosion of creativity as people are finding themselves in through different shamanic techniques. It's about becoming interdimensional and understanding your interdimensional reality, that we do exist across different dimensions in parallel universes, at the same time as we're here. It's not in the future, it's not in the past, it's all in the now. And this is a state of consciousness that creates the reality of our Earth as it is today. We have what's going on the Earth today because not enough people are awake to that reality, basically. And just in waking up to that reality, then if there's a certain amount, I feel, of people that are awake in that way, then there will be a tipping point and you'll see that things will start to change in this world, but it can't change in any other way. It can't change in signing petitions. I absolutely refuse to sign any petitions that are sent to me, because I know they use our petitions to wipe their asses. I'm sorry they do. You cannot go to a tiger who's bitten your head off and ask the tiger to sew it back on again. That's what signing petitions is all about. And anyone that still believes that signing petitions has any effect whatsoever is really deluded and is still not awake. They're not awake to the reality of the monster that we're facing. Sometimes people cannot see how dark this monster really is, because it's so way beyond their envisaging that it's like, because they've never confronted their own dark side, which is part of shamanic work too, that you have to do. And once you have seen it inside yourself, you know it exists. And then you look out and you can see where it exists in the world, and you know then what you have to do about it. So I really hope that is of some help. I want to talk to you a little bit about perspective, because I think the reason a lot of people are kind of teetering on the edge of wanting to do shamanic training but not really sure is a kind of self-esteem thing. And this low self-esteem about who we are has been deliberately engendered in us over, as I say, hundreds of years, if not more than 1,000, maybe even 2,000 years. This gradual eroding of our confidence, of our empowerment, of harrying us off our lands, of our ancestors, where we're rooted in the ancestral wisdom that gave us our self-confidence and our self-empowerment. This has been going on for a long time. And so we are now, I see when I talk to people about this, you know, what I do and what the things, the practices, shamanic practices, and I see them nodding their head and going, yeah, yeah, yeah. But they think, oh yeah, but that's all right for you, because you were obviously meant to do that, because you're blazing with light and you're blazing with confidence. No, I wasn't. I really wasn't. And, you know, you can talk to some of my friends that knew me, say in the early 90s, and I was codependent. I was living with an alcoholic. I was getting regularly beaten up by him, and I did have an interest in spiritual things, but no idea how to, you know, how it would relate to me. It was quite religious, actually. It was very Vedic, very Hindu, very Indian, which is just as much religion as any other religion, really, when it comes down to it. And all these religions make you feel small. They make you feel not good enough. They make you feel that you can't be empowered, because first of all, you've got to purify yourself. Well, yes, you do, but you have to, you know, it's not the way they do it. It's not about feeling guilty and keep praying to God about what a sinner you are. That's not going to get you anywhere. It's just going to make you feel really, really bad. Another way they've done this is because they've changed the religion as well. Over the last few hundred years, they've changed the religion to science, which is also a religion. Religion is a way of looking at things that everyone has decided to believe in, and everyone decides to buy into it and agree to it. A certain set of parameters that are unproven in religion and science. So that's why I think science is a religion. And they did this after the so-called Enlightenment in the 18th century, which is hilarious, really, because it was the opposite of Enlightenment. What happened was that it was decided that nothing would be believed unless it could be rationally proved and measured. Basically, that's what science boils down to. And of course, that would be fine if we were all knowing beings, but we are not. In terms of what we need to know at that stage of the so-called Enlightenment, we, you know, if you think of an enlightened being as a fully developed adult, then we were actually children in a primary school that have barely proceeded past learning in maths tens and units, you know, how to add up tens and units. I remember that stage very well, because it was I found it very difficult when I had to learn to carry the one, you know, and I never was very good at maths, but I do remember it, because that was like maybe 6 years old. I don't know what they do nowadays in schools, but that was, I was about 6 years old at the time when we had to learn to carry tens and units. And that's the stage that man is at. So it's all very well saying, well, we're not going to believe anything unless we can make it fit into our understanding of maths, which is at the stage of tens and units. And it's like, no, sorry, you need to be beyond calculus to even start to get this. In fact, you need to be talking to quantum scientists, quantum physicists, because they're starting to get it. But they're still searching outwardly, and it's an inward search. And this is all part as well of the dumbing down of the self-esteem, this making it only outward, because the power comes from within. But all their microscopes and telescopes are trained outwards, because if you think about the universe and how huge it is, and if you were, say, to travel from this universe in some way, maybe you could fly. So you'd fly up, and maybe the first planet you'd come to would be the moon, go on a bit further, the sun, and then the other planets, Mercury, Venus, Mars, and you'd fly past those, and then you'd come into the other constellations, the fixed stars, and then you keep on going and going and going, and you'd come into the most amazing places of black holes and red dwarfs and universes, you know, appearing, building, growing, dying, quasars, stars dying. And then you look back to Earth, what would you see? You just see, maybe you might see a speck. If you've got really good eyesight, you might see something that looks like a speck of dust. And that is the outward perspective. It's like, so if this Earth, which is 4 billion years old, is just a speck of dust, and maybe even less than that, maybe a nano speck of dust, and it's only 4 billion years old, and man has only been on this nano speck of dust for, well, that we know of, a few million years, then what am I? Who am I? You'd feel like nothing. And that's how you're meant to feel. Because that's what the outward journey does. The outward perception makes you feel like nothing. And, you know, that's how you want your slaves to feel. So it's all been deliberately engineered in us. What we have to do is explore inner space, because actually, in that way, yes, we are nothing, but in another way, we are everything, everything. And that perspective only comes from going in, doing that same journey outwards to the stars, but you do it inwardly. And that's what the shaman does. So the shaman goes into these inner worlds, and goes to the inner sun, inner planets, inner star systems, and meets there with entities who we call spirits, guiding spirits. And the ones that I meet with are purely concerned with the spiritual evolution of the human being. They're purely concerned with meeting the human being and teaching them what they need to know about who they are and why they are here. And isn't that the question you're never, never, never allowed to ask? Even scientists, I don't know if any scientist has ever asked for funding to ask that question. But I don't, you know, I think probably they would be refused it anyway, because with the tools they have, it would be like trying to measure the ocean with a teaspoon. So, you know, they couldn't do it anyway, and the people that provide the funding would probably know that. It has to be done inwardly. It's an inward spiritual journey where you get in touch with this operating system that's already downloaded into you. It's part of your anatomy and physiology. It's part of your nervous system, sympathetic nervous system, parasympathetic nervous system. And it's, more importantly, it's part of your DNA. And that gives us the connection back to the ancestors, so that we can benefit from their wisdom as well. So they're there to guide us as well. In what our destiny is, why did we come into this world, and what are we here for? It's the most basic question, and yet you're never allowed to ask it. And for every other single thing we do on this earth, we need to know why we're doing it. You know, if I was to go out, put my coat on now and go out, I wouldn't, you know, I might be going out for a walk, I might be going out to the shops to do some shopping, I might be going to a meeting, I might be going to a concert, but I'd know why I was putting on my coat and going out the door. Every single thing we do in a day, we know why we're going to do it. We know what we're doing and why we're doing it. But why we're actually here on this earth, we are not allowed to ask. And it isn't something that can be told to you anyway in words. It is a benefit and a product of the inner shamanic journey that you will need to start making as soon as you can. Anyone listening to this broadcast, I want you please to find your nearest shaman. If you don't know who they are, get in touch with me and I'll find you, because there are so many shamans out there now. There are so many since the 60s that have been trained in this, that it would be very unusual if you didn't have one near you. Because I want you to get in touch with this other half of who you are. We're all, until we meet, reach this point, we're all just walking around as half beings, not in touch with the other half of who we are. And because of that, we can't recognize anything on this earth in its true reality. And so we're in no way in any position to do anything about it. And protest marches and petitions will be completely useless. That it's only in becoming self-empowered into our own destiny by going inwards in the way that a good shaman can teach you how to do. So I hope that's helped a little bit. I just wanted to say that today. I want you to think about it. I want you to ask questions. If you have any questions, you're really welcome to send them to me. Just contact me, send them to me. I'm on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, you can get me everywhere really. And start thinking about how this applies to you. There's a reason why I have this self-confidence to broadcast in this way. There's a reason why I have the self-confidence to write in the way that I do. And sometimes people say to me, oh, you're such a good writer. Well, I tell you, I get a lot of help. I get a lot of inspiration from the spirits, because I've been practicing this path now for more than 10 years. And you could be doing this too if you wanted, or just doing it in your own way. So thank you for listening, and I look forward to talking to you again next time. Thanks.